will first hear today from North Carolina Attorney General Roy Cooper. Attorney General Cooper was first elected to this office in 2000. He was previously the managing partner of his law firm, Fields & Cooper. He served as a member of the State House of Representatives from 1987 to 1991, and in the State Senate from 1991 to 2001. Please join me in giving a warm Wilmington welcome to Attorney General Roy Cooper.
Thank you very much, Rob. Thank you, Rob, and good morning, Wilmington. I'm delighted to be here with you today. I think we all need to take a moment to think about the people who are victims of flooding in southeastern North Carolina right now. It is a difficult situation for many families, and remembering what we went through in northeastern North Carolina with Floyd, I know that some people are in difficult shape. So all people in state government are working to try to help that situation. I appreciate the opportunity to come here. A number of people have said, you've been to Wilmington a lot. I said, well, that's easy. That's easy. All you have to do is just look out and see what an incredible place and a vibrant place this is. But it's part of eastern North Carolina, and that's where I grew up. I grew up in Nash County. My mom and dad put me out to work on the farm very early in my life. Tobacco, cucumbers, pigs, cows, the whole deal. And it was every summer until I went to college. One thing I learned was hard work, was dedication, and that I really wanted a job with air conditioning when I grew up. And I'm grateful to the people of North Carolina for giving me that opportunity. I learned a lot about people. I learned a lot about dedication. And I'm grateful to my parents for the values that they gave to me growing up in eastern North Carolina and for the people in my community. My mom and dad taught me the value of a dollar. They taught me a deep and abiding faith. My parents taught my Sunday school lessons, and then I in turn taught the Sunday school lessons of my three daughters. And we learned about community and the kind of success you can have if you had the right opportunities and you worked hard. One of the things I learned from my mom, my dad too as well, was public education. My mom was a public school teacher. And I've told this many times, but I go all over the state, and every once in a while somebody will come up to me and say, I want to pay you a compliment. I'll think it's about me, and they'll say, your mom was the best teacher I ever had. And it's all over the state. All over the state. She made a difference. And I'm grateful for the education, the public education that I got in North Carolina, my public education my three daughters got. I came back home to practice law in Rocky Mount. And I did that for 18 years. And I represented people in small business and learned about the challenges that they face. I also learned about running a small business myself as I was the managing partner over the last few years. I served in the North Carolina House and Senate while I had an active law practice and running my law firm, and my wife Kristen and I raising three daughters. So that was a very busy time in my life, but I learned so much, and I am so grateful to this state for the opportunity. I also wanted to let you know that I'm proud of North Carolina, and I'm proud that I was born here. I'm grateful to the people who have chosen this state to live. When you think about it, we were the first state in this country to open our doors to higher education supported by the public. We became a beacon in the South during the 60s, during the Civil Rights era. Southern states were making different decisions, but we had a governor by the name of Terry Sanford who stood up and talked about racial fairness and equality and set us apart from other Southern states. We have a long way to go with race relations, and the business community has to play a significant role in eliminating discrimination and creating opportunities. But North Carolina, over the years, has been a beacon. We also have been an example to other states. My good friend, Governor Jim Hunt, who has endorsed me in this campaign, he and I worked together on an innovative early childhood education program called Smart Start that we were able to expand to 100 counties. And people across the country looked at North Carolina and emulated that program. And Governor Hunt and I believed that every single child, no matter where they live, no matter what socioeconomic status, no matter what color, they deserve the chance to be ready to learn when it was time for them to go to school. And that's the kind of foundation that North Carolina has built over the decades. We were seen as a shining light. But over the last few years, some things have changed. For decades, you could travel across this country, in the world even. People would ask you where you're from. You'd say North Carolina. They'd say, oh, your beaches and mountains, your Research Triangle Park, your incredible universities, your bank. Now the question is, what in the world is going on in North Carolina? You know it. You've heard it. You've heard your business associates talk about it. We can fix this, but first we have to realize that there are problems. Here are the challenges that I see North Carolina facing, and then I'll take a few minutes to tell you how I believe we should address those challenges and move our state forward. First, unfortunately, we have a governor and leadership in the General Assembly who are putting political ideology ahead of the best interests of our state and ahead of jobs and schools. When you pass legislation like House Bill 2 that writes discrimination into the law, not only is it wrong, but it has cost our state thousands of jobs, hundreds of millions of dollars that we know about. And most of you who are involved in economic development know that it's just the tip of the iceberg, that there are companies, particularly Fortune 500, who are just taking us off the list until we do something about this. You just had investors come into our state who control $2 trillion worth of investment, $2 trillion with a T. They said House Bill 2 was hurting our economy, and not only that, that it was the equivalent of state-sponsored recession. And we haven't seen the full force and effect of this, but it is coming. And we already have suffered with PayPal, with jobs in Asheville, with cancellations of concerts and seminars and the NCAAs and the ACC, and it's going to continue until we do something about it. But that is putting partisan political ideology ahead of the best interests of our state, as is the refusal to accept billions of dollars, billions with a B, of tax money that we have already paid to Washington that could come back to North Carolina and ensure hundreds of thousands of people at 100% federal dollars to expand Medicaid to people, many of them working, many of them veterans. And when you have a governor and a legislature who just say no to that, because of partisan ideology that has something to do with the Affordable Care Act, therefore I am opposed to it, it's wrong. Look at other conservative Republican governors across this country who've looked at this. Now, they may disagree with the policy, but they also figured, hey, this policy is set, it has been made. This is going to create tens of thousands of good-paying healthcare jobs in my state. This is going to help our private employers with their insurance premiums, because guess what? When you reduce the indigent population, you put yourself in a better position for better insurance premiums. And therefore, Governors like Chris Christie of New Jersey said yes for New Jersey. Governor John Kasich of Ohio said yes for Ohio. Even Governor Mike Pence, who is now on the presidential ticket, has said yes for Indiana. But Governor McCrory has said no for North Carolina. Go ask your rural health care providers about this issue, and they will tell you. Now, there are other issues that are happening right now that I believe cause us to face significant challenges. I believe during the last few years that we have not invested in public education as we should. And I am talking cradle to college. Early childhood investment is stagnant. We have not done what we should do and what we have the opportunity to do with K through 12, nor our community colleges or our universities. I listen to educators a lot. My mom taught me that. And the other day, a third grade teacher came up to me and said, "I'm depressed. And it's not just the pay, but it's the lack of respect that I'm getting from Raleigh." And as soon as she said that to me, I immediately thought about my third grade teacher, Ms. Batchelor. And I told her, I said, "My teacher in the third grade was Ms. Batchelor, and she hugged me the morning my grandmother died. And she made a real difference in my life, as did so many teachers I had, as did college professors and even law school professors that I had." And I told her, "You have no idea the difference that you are making in the lives of these kids, molding parents and teachers and leaders of tomorrow." And I told her to hang on, because we're gonna make a difference. I'm gonna win this race, and we're going to change things to make sure that we invest in our teachers. I was the Senate Democratic Majority Leader from 1996 to 2000, and we raised teacher salaries. We went from 42nd in the country to 21st in the country in 4 years. It can be done. It has to be done. Right now, we're 41st in teacher salaries, 44th in per student spending. That's not enough. We also have to realize that our community colleges are going to be the drivers of workforce development. Because what we are seeing now in our economy, yes, unemployment has gone down. There's been a national recovery. But you go talk to everyday working people, they will tell you they are working longer and harder and for less money than they were before the recession. And most of them would be right, because we do have wage stagnation in North Carolina. And part of the problem is that the jobs that we have created, many of them are lower paying jobs. We have to realize that there's a new economy. We are in a global war for talent. We need to be selling our state. We need to make sure that we have the kind of job training that we need to make things better. But that's not happening now. Our economic development strategy is not coordinated. We have spent 2 years in the Department of Commerce trying to change the structure, developing this public-private partnership, which may be a good idea, but we've lost so much time in recruitment. And we do not have a data-driven strategic plan on incentives. Hey, you got something that works here with film incentives? But you knock it for a loop when it's working? That makes no sense. And you do have a lot of the job development investment grants that are going to Raleigh and Charlotte, but we have to figure out a way to reformulate those and to make sure they are targeted, because incentives can matter, and incentives can get North Carolina to the table. And yes, we need to continue to go after the big manufacturers, but we also have to remember that small business will be the place where most of our good-paying jobs are going to be created. So we have to create an atmosphere that that's positive for small business. We also have to make sure that we are moving forward in a forward track. I look at the fact that we've had no movement in transportation funding. There was a failure to get a transportation bond. So what we have to do is to make sure we pull together and to get one. I think that together we can meet these challenges, and I think that the key to it all is going to be leadership. We need a governor who understands the issues. We need a governor who understands when state government needs to help business and when it needs to stay out of the way. I will be a jobs governor. I will be a governor who will be good for business, not only in Wilmington, but across the state of North Carolina. One of the first things I would want to do would be to organize the business community in North Carolina to make sure we find some way to get House Bill 2 off the books, to make sure that we remove that discrimination, but that we also remove this unnecessary hurdle that we have created for ourselves. I will work with you and healthcare providers and others to make sure that we leverage federal dollars, not only for our military bases, not only for our community colleges and education, but for healthcare, because we have significant challenges, and I will work with you to do that. I will work with you to make sure we invest in education. When I talk to CEOs for the kinds of companies that we want to come to North Carolina, and I ask them, I say, all right, what can we do in North Carolina to get you to come here, to get you to expand here? The first thing I hear now is House Bill 2, but long term, they say, you need to get me the people who can perform the jobs that I create. It's workforce development. It is bridging the skills gap. The number one question of the companies we want is not, what is your corporate tax? We have to make sure we invest in people. We're going to have to pull together to get a transportation infrastructure bond. We're going to have to streamline our Department of Commerce and make sure it is nimble, make sure it pays attention to local economic developers, make sure that we play to our strengths in each part of our state, because we all have strengths in North Carolina. Wilmington here, with our ports, with our tourism, with our film industry. There's so many vibrant things happening here. And you have one of the great universities in UNC Wilmington and Cape Fear Community College. And they can be the centers of this workforce training and development and innovation. There are so many people across this country now who are choosing where they want to live before they start their business. So we have to create the kind of inviting North Carolina. It's going to be good for their business. It's going to be a place that they want to live. It needs good schools and transportation and the kind of people that they need to perform their jobs. That is what we need. Now, this is going to require leadership, and it's going to require consensus building. I probably will be governor with a Republican-led legislature. And I get the question, all right, what can you do? How can you do this? Well, you have a lot of people running for office who will tell you they're going to be bipartisan. But I will acknowledge to you that we as a country and a state have never been as politically divided as we are right now. Opinions are hardened. You've got MSNBC, you've got Fox News, you've got social media and the internet, and people aren't listening to each other. But in my travels across the state, people are hungry for leaders who can find consensus, I've done it before. I have a track record. Number one, I'm proud of my record as Attorney General. For every $1 that has been appropriated to the Department of Justice, we've returned $4 to the state. We've worked hard to represent everyday North Carolinians. We have worked hard to train law enforcement and to make sure that people are safe. But what I know is that we're going to be faced with many challenges as we move forward. And I have worked with Republican district attorneys, Republican sheriffs. We've agreed that law enforcement is nonpartisan, and we're moving forward. And when I was the Senate Majority Leader, the North Carolina House was Republican. And I was the one often who was the one who went and found ways to move forward. We found ways to get teacher salaries to the national average and expand Smart Start and to cut taxes. And I was able to help to build that consensus. I know a lot of Republicans who strongly support public education in our universities and our community colleges. And I know a lot of Democrats who believe in creating a good business environment for our businesses to create better paying jobs. The key is a leader who can bring them together. It's not going to be easy, and it's going to be contentious in many ways. But what we have to do is to take that step, and we have to work together. I am so grateful for the opportunity to be here. And Rob, I know that you wanted to call on some people for questions. I'll tell you this, I believe that North Carolina is better than this. We have incredible potential here in this state and here in Wilmington. And I look forward to working with you to make sure our state moves forward. Thank you very much.
This actually is a question for both candidates. When are you going to bring back the film industry to Wilmington? I'm over here, Mr. Cooper.
Where?
When are you, when are you going to bring back our film industry so my next door neighbor Glenn does not have to leave his family for weeks at a time to go get work down in Georgia? Thank you.
I strongly opposed damaging film incentives. Governor McCrory signed that budget doing that very thing. I know that incentives can be difficult, and particularly for legislative leaders. That's why we have to be data-driven and fact-driven. Data shows me that film incentives in North Carolina were working. I was even down here visiting with my family in Wrightsville Beach, and I'm not going to name the store, but I went into a store. The lady recognized me and said, "You gotta bring back the film industry. It's hurting us a lot here." So that just gives you an example of the ripple effect of the loss of jobs and the loss of work. I will fight for film incentives. I think it's even broad, film incentives are even broader than the data that you see, because I think that it gives North Carolina a panache, or it gives North Carolina a positive image out across the country and the world. I will fight for those incentives. I will fight to help bring back this industry to North Carolina and to Wilmington. You've built too good of a foundation here for us to let it go. There's still time, but we've got to have the right leadership.
Next question is from Dave Hoff.
Yeah, Mr. Cooper, You mentioned leadership a couple times in your remarks, and I work in the area of leadership development. One of the things that we know is how important flexibility is to being an effective leader. Can you give us an example of where you've had to demonstrate flexibility in your role as Lieutenant Governor?
Well, flexibility is key to leadership. When I was the Senate Majority Leader and we were negotiating with the Republican leadership, you can't be dogmatic on every issue. I have my principles. I have things that I want to fight for. For example, I believed during those sessions when we were negotiated that we should have tax cuts. But the leadership in the House wanted them to go all the way up. I wanted them to be focused on the middle class. We were able to get that, but we were not able to get as much as we wanted, so we had to be flexible. And anytime you enter into a consensus building exercise, a leader has to understand that in order to reach an agreement, both sides have to find some victory. And it may be something that you're not that fond of. But what you have to do is assess what's important. And I have done that time and time again as we have moved forward in fighting for our school violence plans and fighting this opioid addiction. Right now we're looking at ways to fight it with the prescription drug monitoring program and trying to eliminate these pill mills, and we're having to achieve success in increments. And so flexibility is a critical part of leadership, because you can't just stand up and just say no, no, no with this House Bill 2. I'm just going to say Governor McCrory has continued to double and triple down on it in the face of overwhelming evidence that it is hurting our state. And on top of that, in addition to denying there's a problem, he is attacking the businesses who are criticizing this law, furthering the gap. He's got to realize, instead of blaming it on Charlotte and me and the president and left-wing media and NCAA and Bruce Springsteen, You got to stop that, and you got to say, we have a problem. We have to fix it. And that's what leadership is about. Even if it was something that you supported from the beginning, you realize it's not working.
Next question is Chris Holman, table 16.
Good morning.
Chris Holman with Advanced Maintenance and Amos Franchise. I fly out of this great Wilmington airport about three times a month to my businesses in different states and in North Carolina and other regions. I fly back in with a lot of entrepreneurs and business owners. We have some really exciting businesses here in the coastal region in these three counties. One thing we usually end up talking about is how the state can help us. And investment in small business, medium business, and large, we spend a lot of time looking for grants for other industries like the film, and many of us here for years and years have paid our state and local taxes on a regular basis. I would like to hear from both candidates whether you would consider capital investments in your small business as a tax-free zone, almost like we do in school shopping. I could buy more vans, open up in Winston-Salem. I just saw some kind of incentive from the state when I buy new vehicles, equipment, tools, and hire people, that maybe there's a period where we would get a tax-free time, at least kind of a thank you back to us that pay taxes every month, every year on a regular basis, rather than industries that sporadically come into our community at the time. Thank you.
That's a very good question. And
Can you repeat the question? I think some people may have not heard it.
Oh, okay. Well, the question had to do with small business innovators and entrepreneurs that we concentrate so much on incentives like the film industry, are there other things that the state can do, for example, tax credits or incentives for small business and startups in North Carolina that could be more across the board? I think that is a good question, and if you go to my website, roycooper.com, you will see my detailed jobs proposal. And one of those proposals has to do with small business, the innovation and entrepreneur economy, and how the state can help and how the state can stay out of the way. How the state can help. I believe that small business loans can be critical. We have to create access to capital. Our innovation economy has a good base in North Carolina, but our biggest problem is access to capital and trying to generate that. The North Carolina Rural Center has an excellent small business loan program. It needs to be reinforced. And then I think that when we look at tax credits and incentives for small business, we have to analyze the data. Is what will help grow our economy? What is proven to help? And also, what businesses and industries do we want to try to grow in North Carolina? I think that's one of the problems, is that a lot of our JDIG, Job Development Investment Grants, have gone to companies with lower paying jobs. What we have to do is refocus on getting the higher paying jobs. And when you bring in those innovators and entrepreneurs, we need to be a welcoming state. We need to be one that says, we are ready to go. We've got this loan program that is available. If it is the right kind of industry that we've determined should be one that the state provides incentives, then we provide that help to you. We also have to make sure that we, once again, it comes back to investing in good schools. People who want good schools when they come here, they want the well-trained workforce. And we have to make sure that we have a seamless effort with K-12, our community colleges, our universities, and our businesses to make sure they are in the game of working to train the kinds of people for the jobs we want to target here. So I'm going to be excited about working with our chambers of commerce to broaden the perspective to small business to create the loan process. Microloans are another potential that you'll see in my, a couple of states have gone into the microloan and we've worked for banks to help them get started. And there can be tax incentives. I believe in tax incentives for renewable energy. I think renewable energy is a very forward-thinking economic thing now. Not only does it help protect our air and water, but it has started creating good-paying jobs. And you've seen Governor McCrory's administration fight the renewable energy industry lately. So we have to just find where they are. I'd be interested in your thoughts on that, of what kinds of businesses that they're bringing in here, but look forward to working with you on that.
We have time for one more question. It'll come from Robert Rosenberg at table 74.
Mr. Cooper, I have one question for you, and I have the same question for Mr. McCrory. In this day of polarizing politics and negative campaigns, what is the greatest accomplishment that you think your opponent has done in the last 4 years?
You know, I agreed with him on a couple of things. Number one, I think the Connect NC bonds were a good thing. And I worked also to get those passed, but I think that was a good step for North Carolina. I thought it was wrong, and it hurt this area, for the governor to sign a budget that eliminated the historic preservation tax credits. But he realized this was a mistake, and he and many others fought to get them back. So I think both of those are positive accomplishments, but I think I can do better. Thank you all very much. I appreciate it.
We will next hear from North Carolina Governor Pat McCrory. Governor McCrory was elected to this office in 2012. He previously worked at Duke Energy for nearly 30 years and served for 14 years as the mayor of Charlotte and on Charlotte City Council before that. Please join me in giving a warm Wilmington welcome to Governor Pat McCrory.
Thank you very much. Thank you all very much. Go Seahawks. All right, now let me talk facts and not rhetoric. The fact is, 3.5 years ago, North Carolina had the fifth highest unemployment rate in the United States of America. Fact, North Carolina had a $500 million misforecast on Medicaid spending by the Easley and Perdue administration. Fact, North Carolina had the highest income tax and corporate tax in the Southeast. Fact, teachers had not been given pay raises for over 5 years in North Carolina, and beginning teachers were getting $30,000 per year, and teacher pay had gone from 17th in the nation to 48th in the nation when I came into office as governor on January the 5th, 2013. Fact, our universities, our science labs, our engineering facilities, our state parks were in horrible condition as I traveled throughout this state. And we were supposed to be recruiting the best doctors and the best engineers in the world, and our facilities were 1950 and 1960 facilities. Fact, Governor Nikki Haley, when campaigning with me in 2012, behind closed doors, said to me, "You know, Governor, we in South Carolina don't even consider North Carolina competition anymore." This is coming from the governor of South Carolina, a person who I admire a great deal, was a very good friend of mine. South Carolina was beating North Carolina because we were overregulated, we had high taxes, we had corruption, political corruption. We did not have a business-friendly environment. And I turned to Nikki Haley, who was a good friend of mine, I said, "Nikki, when I get elected governor, we're going to kick your tail in South Carolina." And she said, "May the best woman win." So I hired Sharon Decker as my commerce secretary from Rutherford, North Carolina. Sharon came here many times, as long as her, and so has her successor, John Scavarla. And we've been fighting for jobs in a very, very tough environment. We were at 9.4% unemployment. This county was over 9% unemployment 3.5 years ago. 3.5 years ago. Those are the facts, not rhetoric. So what did we do? I came into Raleigh as an outsider because I had to turn around the Easley, Perdue, Cooper mindset of doing the same things over and over again and expecting the same results. And let me tell you the toughest decision I had to make in my first 3 months in office was I realized that we had a $2.6 billion debt that you as business people owed the federal government because Beverly Perdue had extended unemployment month after month after month upon the directive of our president. And it was borrowed money. You didn't read about this in the Wilmington Star, or the Raleigh News Observer, or the Charlotte Observer. The state of North Carolina was borrowing $2.6 billion to extend unemployment. And in addition to that, they were ready to increase every one of your unemployment taxes per employee to pay off that debt or to extend unemployment even further. So I got my team together, including Sharon Decker, and said, "Should we keep doing the same thing, or will we get the same results, or should we change now?" I treated it as a business question. And the fact of the matter is, North Carolina had to move, and it had to move now. We couldn't rely on the old policy of what Roy Cooper and Mike Easley and Beverly Perdue had been supporting. And guess what I did? I said, we're going to be the first state not to extend unemployment. In fact, we're going to create employment centers instead of unemployment centers. So when people sign up for unemployment, our goal is not to get them on unemployment. Our goal is to get them a job or a GED or get them into our great community college system. And then guess what we did? We decided to pay off the debt. And I'm proud to announce, as of 9 months ago, this administration paid off $2.6 billion in debt to the federal government. And that's good news for North Carolina, and that's good news for the business people of North Carolina. And I've even got better news. As of my budget directors in the audience, and as of 2 weeks ago, guess what? We now have $2 billion in reserves. In case there is another recession, it's not if, but when, our economy turns in our country and the world. But now, as opposed to what other governors didn't do, they depleted the reserves during the good days. I'm not doing that. I'm building up the reserves. Even during political season when it's easy to hand out money, I'm not doing that because it's the wrong thing to do. So our unemployment reserves are now over $2 billion in reserves in case there is another downturn. But I'll tell you, there is a Carolina comeback. There's a Carolina comeback right here in Wilmington. And it's due to a change in philosophy and a change in culture in state government that had been stagnant for years. And I had to come in and step on the toes of both the right and the left. Heck, I even sued my own Republican state legislature. It wasn't a partisan issue. It was a change of culture that we had to make in Raleigh. And it had to take an outsider to make it happen. And that's exactly what we did. And I'll tell you, I'm the only candidate running for governor this year who's actually got his teaching degree. I got my teaching degree at Catawba College in 1978. Yes, you can do the math. I'm turning 60 next month. But I still got the energy to make things happen. And one thing I realized in my first year, once we reduced our deficit, and I'm proud to report, as of last week, I think we have over $400 million surplus in our budget when the state of Virginia has a $1.5 billion deficit. And remember when we cut the income taxes and we cut the corporate tax, all the liberal prognosticators, including my opponent, said, oh my God, we're in trouble, we're gonna have deficit, the world's gonna fall apart. Just the opposite occurred. We're collecting more money from business tax and income tax now after we cut your taxes because we're generating income. We're generating income. We have a surplus, not a deficit. We've reduced the corporate tax from 6% to 3%. We've reduced your income tax from the high sevens to the low fives. So now we're lower than South Carolina, we're lower than Virginia, and people aren't going across the border to save 2% money. And that's good news for North Carolina. These are the tough business decisions that had to be made during the last 3 years. And guess where we got the money for pay raises for teachers? We got it because we started growing the economy again. And the first pay raises I gave were to two groups of people. One you don't hear about because they don't have a very loud lobbying group. And that was state prison guards. You don't know about that either. State prison guards were making $28,000 a year, and I was having two or three injured every month. In fact, we just had some serious injuries yesterday with some three got stabbed. No one hears about our state prison guards, but the minute I heard our state prison guards were making $28,000 a year for 12 months of work behind the walls with some of the most dangerous people, I made an immediate correction. That's what a change agent does. And when I found out our teachers were making $30,000 a year, especially in those areas where they can afford those supplements, I made a commitment to get their pay from $30,000 to $35,000 a year. Again, that's not enough. But that's a $5,000 pay for every teacher with 1 to 7 years of experience. And now I'm proud to say, last year we had the largest teacher pay increases in the United States of America because we grew the economy and we cut waste and we're putting money where it belongs, and that's in the pockets of our teachers who deserve that money and our law enforcement. That's results, not politics, of someone just saying, we can do better, we need leadership, we need this. I'm actually telling you what we did, not what someone wants to do. I'm telling you what we did, and the results speak for themselves in North Carolina. We have the fourth fastest growing economy in the United States of America right now. This is coming from just 3.5 years ago being the fifth highest unemployment rate in the country. We just got, 2 weeks ago, it was announced we're down to 4.7%, below the national average. This isn't because the national economy is growing at a certain rate, because it's growing very slowly. This is because North Carolina is booming, much greater than almost every state in the union. This didn't happen by accident. It happened because of leadership. But I didn't just sit on my laurels and say, we got to put out the fires of state government. And I got to tell you, when I came in office, I was shocked at how broken state government was. I'll tell you how broken it was. When Ann and I went to go get sworn in, I was sworn in as the 74th governor of the greatest state in the United States of America, North Carolina. No ands, ifs, or buts. Ann and I were walking by the beautiful fountains in front of the old state capitol building that was built in 1841. Many of us toured that building in fifth grade, no matter how old we are. Raise your hand if any of you toured the old state capitol building in fifth or sixth grade. Well, we were walking by the old fountains, beautiful fountains, and guess what? They weren't working, and they were full of trash and dirty water. I remember my wife said, they could have cleaned up the place. Well, 2 days later, I came out of my office, my brand new office in the 1841 building where I had to pinch myself every time I walk in there. And I saw that the fountains were still full of dirty water, trash, and debris, and not working. The only difference was some kids were putting their feet in it. And I turned to a state employee and I said, what the heck's going on here? And he said, I don't know, it's been that way for 5.5 years. That's the front yard of our state. And no one was even paying attention to the little things that were broken. And as you know in business, when the little things are broken, the big things are broken too. And we had a lot of things broken that I just stated, like the highest income tax and the highest corporate tax in the Southeast, like a $500 million misforecast in Medicaid, like a $2.6 billion debt. So my team had to solve those problems, because if you want a problem solver, you've got it right here. We've been doing it for 3.5 years, and the results speak for themselves. But now we've given teacher pay raises. Now we've rebuilt the economy. We've got a surplus. We're competing against South Carolina. Nikki and I talk to each other about once a week, and we yell at each other about who got what. In fact, I just called her up and bragged about it. The attorney general's talking about all these businesses we're losing. We just got one of the biggest job announcements in Asheville, outside of Asheville, 520 people, a high-tech company. Ladies, and the Wilmington area is doing extremely well, and we're getting some good business leads. Believe me, our pipeline is full. Now, during all this good news, something happened in February. And it didn't come from my party. It came from Roy Cooper's political left through the eyes of the mayor of Charlotte, Jennifer Roberts. And I just got to tell you what it is. I was mayor of Charlotte for 14 years. And the current mayor of Charlotte, who had just been elected, decided to bring up an issue that no one had ever heard of, including me. And it was because of a very powerful Washington interest group that was very supportive of not just Jennifer Roberts, but also of Roy Cooper. He's raised millions of dollars on this issue. That's why he keeps talking about it, because he's raising money on this issue. And the issue basically was the city of Charlotte passed a mandate on all businesses in Charlotte-Mecklenburg that you would have to recognize the concept of gender identity and gender expression if you open up your restrooms, locker rooms, or showers to anyone in the public, including your own employees. This was the left that brought it up. Now, I frankly don't, and by the way, there was a fine if they did not do it. I personally think it's not the city government's business or the state government's business or the federal government's business to tell you in business what your locker room, shower, and restroom policy should be. And that's not the rules in North Carolina. It's none of our damn business. You can do whatever you want. I've got my opinion on it, but you can do whatever you want in North Carolina right now. And all of us disagree with any type of discrimination. This has nothing to do with discrimination, despite what the left wing says. This has to do with basic privacy. When you go into a restroom, locker room, or shower facility. And the left right now wants to change the definition of gender based upon what you think you are, based upon what you are. And it's become a national debate that was brought here to North Carolina for strictly political purposes based upon the political state of North Carolina. And Roy Cooper and Jennifer Roberts helped bring it here. And now that's all they talk about. Because guess what? The definition of politics is the art of diversion, and they want to divert the attention away from the incredible economic success and education success that we've had in the state of North Carolina. And I got to tell you, and I'll be honest with you, it's not going to be Roy Cooper or Jennifer Roberts or Pat McCrory who changed the definition of gender. In the next several months, it'll probably be the U.S. Supreme Court, because 21 other states, including the state of North Carolina, do not believe that the Justice Department or the City of Charlotte should be able to tell the private sector what your rules and regulations should be. That will be a decision made by the U.S. Supreme Court. But I will tell you this as governor. If that your kid goes to an elementary school or a junior high or a high school in North Carolina, or if you stop at a rest stop on the highway in North Carolina, or if you go to a state park in North Carolina, or your kid goes to a university, right now in North Carolina, the only rules we have apply to our state facilities, and it says you go to this restroom or shower or bathroom facility based upon your gender, of what it is, not what you think it is. You know, our state motto is to be, not to seem. That's all this is about. It's a legitimate debate. I respect those who disagree with me, and it's something that's going to be settled. It was purposely brought to North Carolina at North Carolina's expense. And I got to let you know the truth. That's why he keeps bringing it up, because he's raising money in New York City and California on this issue. A lot of money. But beyond that, let me tell you what we did. I did propose the North Carolina Connect bonds. We had not had a bond in North Carolina since 2001 to invest in our universities, our parks, our military. And I visited them, and they were in terrible shape, especially for members of our military. The men and women who go to Afghanistan and Iraq, they were coming home to facilities that were built in the 1950s and 60s. By the way, they were not adapted to now for women in the military, which they need to be adapted to. And I immediately said, we need to change this. So I proposed a bond to the people of North Carolina for our state parks, which include Fort Fisher and others right around here, which needed fixing, which included UNC Wilmington, which included your incredible community college, which is one of the best in the United States of America, not just North Carolina. And we're putting money based upon those bonds. I said no money for football stadiums, no money for swimming pools, no money for basketball arenas, with all due respect. We're going to put the money in science labs. We're going to put the money for nursing facilities. We're going to put the money for engineering facilities, for welding facilities, for truck driving school. Do you see where the connection is? It's where we have shortages of talent right now in North Carolina. So everything we've done has been strategic. And if we're going to spend money, we're going to spend it in targeted areas where we need to help employers and help the economy of North Carolina. And it was approved by 67% of the vote. I did want road bonds on there. I'm sad to say the Attorney General did not write me one email or make one phone call to help get roads on the bonds. In fact, one thing the Attorney General hasn't told you, he's only done 5 emails in his 14 years as Attorney General. Have you met any leader who's only written 5 emails in 14 years? Leadership is communicating with people and telling them where you can take a stand on an issue. And I've done that with the bonds, and 67% of the people have agreed with that. And now for the next 10 years, we're going to be spending this money, including at UNCW, a beautiful, beautiful new facility to help our sciences and nursing. It's going to be fantastic at UNCW. This is the change that we've made in North Carolina. And I ask for your continued support. This is the greatest state in the United States of America. My dad, when he ran for the Worthington, Ohio City Council before he was smart enough to move the family to North Carolina in 1966 when I was 9 years old, he had a line, and I stick with it often. It says the following: we must walk the fine line between continuing our economic prosperity while also protecting the values, quality of life, and environment that brought many of us here. And that's the fine line that strong leadership walks, whether you're mayor, or whether you're governor, or whether you're president. And I'm walking that fine line of continuing economic prosperity for the state of North Carolina, but I'm also going to protect the values and quality of life and environment that make North Carolina second to no state in the United States of America. Thank you, and God bless each one of you. I look forward to your questions. Thank you very much. All right, give me some big ones now.
All right, first big question from Hanson Matthews, table 66.
Hi, Governor McCoy. First of all, I'd like to say you've done some really impressive things in the office, and retiring $2.6 billion was probably the most impressive with the federal debt. However, as you know, all politics is local. Wilmington's brand has been the film industry, just like Charlotte's has banking. And there are 900 local people in this room who will tell you if you drive to 23rd Street, our industry has been decimated. It hasn't been impacted. Will you reconsider your position to restore the tax credits to what they were when we were actually competitive with states like Georgia and Louisiana?
Let me tell you what I've done. The Attorney General talked about compromise, and that's what you have to do because it's the legislature that determines that budget. And the legislature was ready to eliminate any incentive. They had the votes to eliminate everything for the film industry. So what I did as governor was make a compromise with them because they had the votes to do this, because we had other parts of the state that wanted incentives for other types of industries, and they were going, why does the film industry get special classification over other incentives? And so I made a compromise, and the compromise was we ought to do film grants of $20 million. They reduced it to 10. Now this year we're going to be up to $30 million for film grants for the film industry in the state of North Carolina. I've also got to let you know some of the old film incentives were being taken advantage of, not by people here in Wilmington. Frankly, it was in Charlotte where, for example, the Comedy Channel, it's ironic, they're extremely liberal, but the Comedy Channel took $400,000 of film incentives, cash, which by the way, we could have given to teachers, to go to the Democratic National Convention. By the way, the Republican Convention, I would say the same thing. There was no reason to give the Comedy Channel $400,000 of cash when they were coming anyway. So there were some people taking advantage of the old program, and that's why some people wanted to eliminate it, and I made the compromise, and we've got $20 million for film grants right now. And I'm going to continue to fight for the industry, but I'm also primarily going to fight for the industry in the film area that has permanent placement here, not partial placement where you come and go. But if they invest just like any other industry with a long-term sustainable investment, they should get the same incentives that any industry gets in North Carolina. And that's my strategy for the film industry. And you have some great permanent facilities that I have visited on several occasions here in Wilmington. Other questions?
Next question, table 46, Don Harris.
Good morning, Governor. Our area is defined by our beaches, which we love every day, and people across the state do too. What will you do to provide a sustainable and renewable resource to help us renourish our beaches?
Well, thank you very much. The main issue that I'm working on right now, I don't have a definite plan. I could say right now I'm fighting for a new plan. I've got a plan on my website. We don't have a plan on my website. I apologize for the beaches.
I will say this, the one thing I have done, I think the most serious issue right now is not just the beaches, but in my first 3 years, the most serious issue was dredging. And I've been, in fact, I've met now probably four times with the Army Corps of Engineers. We've bought one or two new dredgers from the state of North Carolina. I've made deals with other counties, including Dare County, to split costs of dredging. We've got some major dredging at your ports that we're dealing with and infrastructure at your ports. And I also might add your port, when I came into office, to tell you how bad broken government was. The Wilmington port didn't even have refrigeration for its products. I'm proud to say, as of the last 3 weeks, you now have refrigeration at the Wilmington port. But the major issue I'm looking at is money for your dredging, which in turn could possibly help some of the beaches erosion that we're having throughout North Carolina. Other questions?
Next question is table 67, Ted Shipley.
Good morning, Governor. I have a legal question for you. In 2008, the U.S. Supreme Court upheld Indiana's voter ID law in the case of Marion County versus Crawford, and again upheld Wisconsin's voter ID law in 2011 by a vote of 6-3. Right now, Attorney General Roy Cooper is not defending the state, even though constitutional precedent supports voter ID and a majority of North Carolina voters support voter ID. What is your administration doing to defend the state right now?
Right now, the Fourth Circuit Court has defeated photo ID. There's photo ID in 33 states in the United States of America, and it just happens to be a presidential election this year, and they have denied North Carolina the same rights of 33 other states. I personally think if it's good enough to use a photo ID to get Sudafed, which the Attorney General passed law to do, it's one of the best things he's done, by the way, if that question comes up in the future. The one good thing I can think of is that he's done in 14 years, he required photo ID to get Sudafed, and yet he doesn't think photo ID is good enough to vote in the state of North Carolina. I do. And I think after this election, that whole issue will again go back to the Supreme Court, because it's working fine, and it worked very good in the primary. We had no complaints whatsoever with photo ID in the primary. Our polls are very susceptible to fraud, and when you have tens of millions of dollars on the ground in North Carolina in campaigning, if you think there's not going to be attempts for voter fraud, you're naive. All you have to do is go look at Chicago and Philadelphia and Texas and West Virginia and look at past presidential elections. It can happen when you have that much money on the ground, and we've got to do everything we can to protect the integrity of the ballot box. And sadly, the courts just several weeks ago ruled against us, and the Attorney General, while fighting for us briefly, was raising money, campaign funds, saying he's against photo ID, and he was our lawyer defending photo ID. Now, if your lawyer that you hired to defend you then was publicly raising money for your opponent, you would probably lose your license. But that's not the case with our Attorney General, and I'm sad to say that. He should have been fighting for North Carolina. I'm sworn to uphold the Constitution of not only the state of North Carolina, but the United States. And I've gone against my political right. For example, when gay marriage was passed by the Supreme Court, I immediately had to make changes in our laws and our structure to ensure that people who are gay could get married in North Carolina. I personally disagree with it, but when the Supreme Court rules you to do it, you got to do it, because my job is to obey the Constitution. And even when we had magistrates who said they wouldn't do it, I personally thought they should, because they were sworn to do their job and uphold the Constitution. And this is where I had a very strong disagreement with my political right, and I got a lot of abuse from it. But our first job is to uphold the laws and Constitution of North Carolina and the United States of America, and I have not changed from that viewpoint, whether I agree with the laws or not. And before I forget, I do want to say a special thank you. During the past, I've had a very interesting couple of weeks, and one of the jobs of a leader is to deal with crisis. And last week, I had to deal with three crises at the same time. One was a colonial oil pipe break
where we immediately had shortages throughout the state. The second was a major flood in eastern North Carolina where people are still hurting right now, and do not forget about them. Today we're dealing with a flood in Fayetteville, and also last week I had to deal with protesters in Charlotte. And I just want to thank the National Guard that I am the commander of. I got a call, I made a request to the mayor and the police chief there that said, we're here to help anytime we can. And at that point in time, the mayor said, we don't need any help. After I hung up the phone, I looked at Intel, and I know the city very well, and I predicted that they would need help. So I immediately started getting the National Guard assembled, even though I had not been asked. This is what leadership's all about. And I had many people from Wilmington in the National Guard and up and down the coast who were pulled out of work, who were gotten their buses and Humvees and started traveling to Charlotte. And later on that night at 10:45, I got a call from the police chief of Charlotte and said, we need them. Now, if I had not moved, it would have taken another 10 hours to get them there. And I said, sir, we have them. Some are arriving right now as we speak. We have others that are in Salisbury and Monroe and 30 or 45 to an hour out. They'll be on the street within a very short period of time. Ladies and gentlemen, this is what leadership is all about, having to make the tough decisions. And I'd like to thank the members of the National Guard. These were men and women, a lot who had never been to Charlotte and were put in a very, very tough situation. So we saw some of the best in North Carolina too. Even though we had some anarchists in the crowd, we also had some people that hugged our National Guard. And that was the best feeling in the world when I saw that happening. And so I'd appreciate if you give any members of the National Guard a round of applause. They deserve it. And our Highway Patrol, who we got there. Any other questions?
Yep. Next question is from table 95, Jim Roberts.
Good morning, Governor. Thanks for coming to Wilmington. Nice to see you.
Thank you, Jim.
We worked together quite a bit in Charlotte on entrepreneurship.
You were a young entrepreneur at that time, buddy.
I was. I had a little more hair and a little less weight, but we'll get over that. We enjoyed working with you. One of your initial priorities in your administration was to bring more out-of-state venture capital to North Carolina. I'm having an event that's on page 5 of your business journal next week to address that. What else is your administration doing to attract more out-of-state capital, including people like the great Jody Simone that you promoted? Thank you.
Thank you for great hearing from you again, Jim. I haven't seen you in a while. One of the weaknesses of our economy in North Carolina is that we do not have enough venture capital. And this is really our competition against the Northeast and against California and against Austin, Texas. And so one of the first things I did was develop a program to bring more capital, especially for the small entrepreneur in North Carolina. And it took me 3 years, but I got a bill signed that my staff helped write. And that is a concept called crowdfunding, which we did not have in North Carolina. I kind of think of the Shark Tank TV show. You know how a lot of the people go on Shark Tank? They're just asking for $25,000 or $50,000 or $100,000. That's all they need. And the dilemma they're having in states like North Carolina, they can't get it from the banks and they can't get it from the VC firms, because the VC firms are looking for much bigger investments and much bigger returns. So now in North Carolina, we've got a law in which you can borrow money at $2,000 increments from anyone to build up your business. And by the way, the law is also protecting the investors, because you can't spend any of the money until you raise all the money that you promised the investors. So it's a concept called crowdfunding, and I think it's going to be a game changer in North Carolina, where a small investor can approach 20 people and raise $40,000 just like that for their startup business, which is extremely important to cities like Wilmington and Asheville and Charlotte and any town in North Carolina. Because the 20 to 30 year old or the 30 to 40 year old or people my age have a tough time just getting that little bit of money with the conservatism of many of the banks at this point in time. So it's a concept called crowdfunding. Please call our Department of Commerce if you're interested. Also, Jim, we've got a bill in right now where we're going to start using some of the pension funds investments of North Carolina to invest in second and third round startups in North Carolina. Why shouldn't we be investing the pension funds just in the huge venture capital in New York and California. Why not invest some of that pension fund right here in North Carolina? So we've got a bill approved to do that too. It's got to be extremely structured. We've got to make sure that politics or corruption don't get into that process. So we're making sure that we protect it from any types of politics or corruption. One of the things I've tried to do, Jim, is take the politics out of a lot of things that we used to have in the crony system of North Carolina politics. You know, when I was mayor, I'd drive between Charlotte and Wilmington, and the roads would go from 2 lanes to 4 lanes, back to 2 lanes, back to 4 lanes, to 8 lanes. And did you ever notice where it was widened? It was named after a politician. That meant road decisions were being based upon where the powerful politician happened to live that year, who was speaker, who was the DOT member, and that's who the road are named after in North Carolina. That's wrong. So one of the things I'm proudest of in a bipartisan bill, in fact, most of the bills I presented and were passed were bipartisan, very bipartisan, was a change in our road formula, which helped Wilmington. Because we took the politics out of road building and it's based upon data now. Guess what the number one data point is? How many cars do you have? How's that for thinking out of the box? That wasn't part of the formula before. Does that make sense? The number of cars, congestion, safety, and economic development. Those are the three factors. No ands, ifs, or buts. It doesn't matter where the governor lives. It doesn't matter where the speaker lives. It doesn't matter where the senior senator lives. It's going to be based upon data. I've got some House members now that want to reverse that because they're realizing they lost power. But it's not about power. It's about doing the right thing. And we're doing the right thing in North Carolina government right now, and I'm very, very proud of it. I'm also proud, by the way, y'all got a great new bridge downtown here that we did a joint venture where instead of just building an ugly bridge in downtown Wilmington, we added some stuff to it, and it looks like it actually fits in the neighborhood as opposed to a highway bridge in downtown Wilmington. So I was real proud to work with your mayor on that. You got a good mayor, too.
Thank you. Thank you, Governor.
Thank y'all. God bless each one of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you everyone for attending. Please don't forget that early voting starts on October 20th. Thanks again.